reason you saw a buzz in the choir right before they stood up is they didn't know that they were singing the song from the passage in Isaiah that I was reading. And to tell you the truth, I knew that they were going to sing this song today, but that's not the part of what I think of when I think of Isaiah 6. I think of the worship image, this idea that all of a sudden Isaiah sees the throne of God, God seated on his throne in the temple, and the seraphim are flying around and calling out and all that. And so the only reason that we were reading Isaiah today was because of the worship thing, not because of the "Here I am, send me," which is the last line of that passage, which I knew was there, but wasn't why I picked it at all. So that was a God thing. That's a pretty cool thing. Third grade into the church. Why do we have a church? Why does the church exist? What's the meaning, purpose, and goal of the church? The maintenance of divine worship. We'll talk about that. But we're in Hebrews today, the 12th chapter, and I'll begin in verse 18 of the 12th chapter and read through the end of the chapter. The writer to the Hebrews is making all kinds of Old Testament references, which I just don't have time to talk about, and that's going to drive me crazy. I will make a very, very few notes about that. But you can look them up, and you can go back and read this story. It's the story of Moses about to go up on Mount Sinai and receive the Ten Commandments the first time. So you can look that up this afternoon or later in the week, but we have what we have here. Beginning in verse 18, we're kind of coming in the middle of things, reading through the end of the chapter. "You have not come to a mountain that can be touched and that is burning with fire, to darkness, gloom, and storm, to a trumpet blast, or to such a voice speaking words that those who heard it begged that no further word be spoken to them, because they could not bear what was commanded. If even an animal touches the mountain, it must be stoned to death. The sight was so terrifying that Moses said, 'I am trembling with fear.' But you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly, to the church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. You have come to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See to it that you do not refuse him who speaks. If they did not escape when they refused him who warned them on earth, how much less will we if we turn away from him who warns us from heaven? At that time his voice shook the earth, but now he has promised, 'Once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens.' The words 'once more' indicate the removing of what can be shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful, and so worship God acceptably, with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We had a conversation last week, and I don't know why, about the Olympic torch and the Olympic flame, and how you get the Olympic flame from one place to another, which is actually an interesting question. And in this idea of the maintenance of divine worship, that sounds a little bit like trying to make sure there are no leaks in the ceiling, make sure things are cleaned up, make sure that things are running right. You might lose what's really going on with this idea of divine worship. Similarly, the Olympic flame is symbolizing this great ideal, and the fact that it makes its journey all the way around, well, first in Greece and then comes to whatever country's hosting the Olympics and then makes its way around, there is a maintenance idea there. But I like this connection that in the Old Testament, when God came down to give the Ten Commandments, the mountain looked like it was on fire, a mountain that is burning with fire, and there was thunder and lightning. And then at the very end, last part of that chapter, our God is a consuming fire. The Olympic flame, the Olympic torch has been all kinds of places. It's even been in space. Well, okay, the torch has been in space. When Sochi, Russia was going to host the Olympics, lots of things happened, actually, when Russia was going to host the Olympics last time. But they took the torch up in a Soyuz rocket and they carried it to the International Space Station. But they do not allow an open flame in space with all that oxygen around. So it was just the torch. Kind of disappointing. But it's been on a plane. They've taken the Olympic flame on a plane. You cannot take a large bottle of shampoo on a plane unless you check it in your baggage. But the flame can come into the space where all the passengers are. But it's in a lantern. It's in a contained spot. It's not like a minor safety lantern, really. And that is actually what makes what ensures that the flame, if it goes out, can be lit once again. Because the International Olympic Committee requires that the flame stay lit at all times, which is a requirement we don't always meet. We have to relight it sometimes. It also cannot be in two places at once, they say, which is also not true because there's always backup flames when you're running with the torch or even in the big stadium. You have a lot of backups, and you have flame attendants, people whose whole job is to make sure that if the torch goes out, you can relight it with one of the actual flames that was once lit in Greece and then carried over to where you are. Except again in Sochi, when it went out, and instead of waiting for one of the lanterns with the backup flame, a security officer took out his lighter and lit that thing right back up again, which means the Olympic flame probably didn't make it into the stadium in Sochi. The Olympic flame's been to the North Pole. It's been on a plane, obviously. It goes on a plane all the time. It's been underwater. The flame is everywhere. But I kind of like this idea that the flame is taken from Greece and it's carried all over the world. And since 1936, we've had relays where it goes through the country, wherever it's hosting. But it's sort of a representative of the flame where it came from, the Olympic ideal, right? So you've got the flame that starts in Greece and the Olympic ideal, but it's taken somewhere else. Its source is elsewhere, but the whole point of all the runners and then all the flame attendants and everybody else is to maintain and protect that flame. That's kind of like what happens in worship. Our source is elsewhere, but we are maintaining something that actually in the end doesn't really need us. That may be part of the difference. If in the end all the backup flames went out, they could go back to Greece and try this thing again. But we are called to maintain the worship of God. That's one of the great ends of the church. One of the reasons we have a church at all, and by that I mean global, worldwide Church of Jesus Christ, as well as this congregation. Third great end is to maintain the worship of God, which makes sense. Because the whole chief end, the reason for being of every one of us, the chief end of man, says the Westminster Confession. Our part of the family of faith has been using that for more than 300 years now. But, well, longer than that, actually a good bit longer. The whole reason that humanity exists, the chief end of human beings is to glorify God. That's worship. And to enjoy Him forever. And we'll talk about that. We are called to maintain the worship of God, great end of the church. And it's not really up to us entirely. And it's not only up to us to maintain that worship, but we are kind of like the runners with the torch. When we gather together, it is as we light the Christ candle, for heaven's sakes. That's not Jesus, but it represents the light of the world, Jesus Christ, who comes into the world. We are like the runners carrying the torch, representing the true flame, which comes from somewhere else. Its source is elsewhere, not us. But we are here to help shine that light, make sure that flame is lit, make sure that still the people of God are worshiping God as they have always done. And more than that, worship of God has gone on a lot longer than we ever guess. Real, reverent, awesome, and I mean that in the old good sense of the word, not just sort of a throwaway phrase, and awful, filled with awe, worship is happening right now, has happened since before the world began, since before there was time, and it will last for all eternity. Real, reverent, awesome, awe-filled worship is happening all the time, and we get to be part of it. And that is a mind-blowing, amazing thing. All creation, of course, declares the glory of God. We said that in our call to worship. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the skies declare the work of His hands. When Jesus is making His way into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, one of the gospel writers says that the Pharisees said, "Teacher, you got to get these people to quit saying things like Hosanna and the Son of David and the King and Messiah, and you got to get them to be quiet." And Jesus said, "If they were quiet, the stones themselves would cry out." All creation declares the glory of God, which is an element of worship. Declaring God's glory. Worshiping someone who is worthy of worship. Declaring the glory of someone who is already all glorious. It's the response of creation to the presence of God. That's one of the reasons the mountain lit up with fire. When God comes down on Mount Sinai, a huge dark cloud comes down on the mountain. Like I said, lightning, thunder, the mountain catches fire. There's a trumpet blast. It is a terrifying scene, but God has shown up. And all nature responded to the presence of God. And that's what we do in worship. We respond to the presence of God. We do it in a few ways. What are some elements of worship? What do you have to do to have worship? Well, I'm not going to list them all, but from somebody who's been thinking a lot about worship, I'll read you a couple of things. This one writer said, elements of worship, really, he gives three. These are the three most important ones. One, preaching of the word, which God's people have done since they gave him a word to be preached, but they have understood that. And ever since the living word, Jesus Christ, came down, not only do we call ourselves to worship Jesus Christ, but also remember his words. Great commission, right? Go and teach all these new disciples you're making to obey everything I've commanded. And Jesus says the Holy Spirit does that too. He will remind you of everything that I've commanded. So this is what this one gentleman writes. Preaching the word, it lies at the core of worship. Why? Because it presents Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord by telling the truth about his person and work. The preservation of the truth is one of the great ends of the church. We'll talk about that. But it's at the core of worship because it presents Jesus Christ to us, to all of us, as Savior and Lord by telling the truth about who he is and what he has done. So the response of worship begins in an encounter with the glory of God. That's what John said, right? The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son. Response to the glory of God. And that really is the whole reason we have Isaiah 6 as our Old Testament lesson this morning. Because Isaiah sees a vision of God seated on his throne, and you would think seeing seraphim, which are angels, flying around calling out, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty," Isaiah would say, "Oh, we're worshiping. Where do we begin? I'm ready to join in. What do I do? Do I sing something? Do I say something?" And that's not what he does. He says, "Woe is me." And the translation we have, which is just fine, says, "I am ruined." What he means is, "I'm dead. I'm a dead man because I have seen the living God, and you can't see God and live." And then the seraph comes over and with the burning coal heals him, atones for his sins, and then he stands in the presence of God, and his response is first glory, and then it is, and then of course confession, and then after confession, he is ready to serve. "Here I am, send me." Worship begins in an encounter with the glory of the Lord, which we ought to find in the reading and preaching of the word. Second element of worship is prayer. Prayer is central to what we do in worship, whether we realize it or not, and prayer comes in lots of forms. The opening prayer, the prayer for illumination, but also the prayers of the people, the pastoral prayer for the people. You know that when the people, the Jewish people, before Jesus came along, when they gathered in synagogues to worship, the synagogues were called the place of prayer. Churches now gather for prayer. Praising God, asking God to come and be with us, which I think is kind of ironic because God's already here by the time you ask, but I still like it. But you'll never see a prayer of invocation in our bulletins if I'm leading worship, because invocation means you got to convince God to come down. And the way that Presbyterians have looked at things is God's already there. You're responding to what God's doing. We will also always have a time of prayer for the people. It's central to worship. Prayer is central to worship. If ever you hear a pastor say, "We don't have time to pray for people in worship," you tell them Acts chapter 16. It's the place of prayer. We are here to pray for one another. We are here to praise God. It is part of what makes worship worship, is the prayer of the people for the people of God. Praying, of course, that God's kingdom come and will be done, but also lifting up, carrying each other's burdens, as we've been talking about for weeks. You pray in worship. That's why we're here. Preaching the word, prayer, and song. We sing together. We sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, or songs of the Spirit. They changed the translation on me, but I like that fine in Colossians that Mark read. We sing together. If you are not a singer, you have already been told in your life that the Bible tells you to make a joyful noise. I will repeat that, but I know that's not going to convince all of you. You still should sing. And a joyful noise is a joyful noise, whether it sounds great to our ears or not. It sounds great to God. If you're not going to sing, that's fine too, but I have never yet picked a hymn where I thought, "Well, this is such a good tune, I don't care what the words are, we'll just sing this tune." The words are good, and they're there for you. They're an act of worship and praise. If we even read the words together, it is for your edification, your building up, and your encouragement. Preaching the word, prayer, and song. That is what makes up worship. This writer to the Hebrews here in the end of this, almost at the end of his letter, gives us this incredible vision, first, of what worship's not any longer, which is a terrifying encounter with the living God. He still wants you to be a little bit scared, but he mostly wants you to appreciate what God is offering to you. And he wants you to recognize what's really going on here. because liturgists and pastors and choirs do not always tip you off as to what's actually happening now that you're in your place. I've told you before, one of the great writers of the 20th century said, you know, we have people come in, we hand you a bulletin. I'm completely paraphrasing now, but if you've ever read it, you know what I'm referring to. We hand you a bulletin, we sit wherever you like, as long as it's not somebody else's pew, sit wherever you like. Women come in wearing fancy hats oftentimes, and we have this nice time together. And this writer says, this is the craziest thing. When you come in, we ought to be handing out hard hats, and we ought to lash you to your pews and give life preservers to you, because this is an encounter with a living God who is all holy, all powerful, and in many ways unpredictable. We expect God to be pleased when we sort of sidle up next to him and remind him of all the good things we've done, hoping he won't remember the things we shouldn't have done. We treat God as a vending machine or a pretty harmless, long-bearded gentleman in the sky who mostly thinks we're great. He thinks you're a lot more than great. He died for you. This is a living God at work in this world. And when God shows up, mountains catch fire and trumpets blast, and a voice is heard that makes the people so scared that they who the day before said, yeah, Moses, we can't wait to go up on that mountain and hear God speak to us. And then God shows up and they go, well, you know what, Moses, you go right on up there. You let us know what he says and we'll do it. When you come back down, we'll do everything he says, which didn't happen. You have come. It's amazing the way that he puts this. Old Testament people, they came to Mount Sinai, they wandered in the wilderness, all this. They came up to the temple to worship. Speaking to people who are in Jesus Christ, believers, followers of Jesus Christ, then and now, he says, not one day you're eventually going to be in this great place. He says, you have already come, very clear in the Greek, you have already come to Mount Zion. And I don't mean the hill in Jerusalem, one of the hills on which Jerusalem is founded, not where the temple was. To the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, you have come. When you come in worship, when you come to faith, you have come to heaven, at least to the threshold. You've come to the city of the living God, and things are happening there because God is alive and at work in this world. Please, please, please don't think of heaven as a place where people are mostly bored. We even had, oh my gosh, I almost threw away this children's book, which is saying something if you know me. I've thrown away maybe 3 books in my life. I don't throw away books. I keep almost all of them, sadly. But we had this children's book that I just couldn't stand because it was these little angels. By that, I mean little children who were angels, which is theologically problematic. But we won't go into that. Here's the thing. They're sitting around, wonder what we should do. Oh, look at that star. That star looks a little dusty, which is now gone from theologically problematic to scientifically problematic. That star is a little dusty. Let's just dust that off. And so the whole book is basically shining up the stars because they needed something to do because it's boring up there. It is not boring up there. And you are not going to find yourself floating on a cloud with a strange-looking harp that you don't know how to play and every so often give it a pluck of the string. Things are happening because it's the city of the living God, and it is bustling. You have come. You have come. You have come. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly. That's what worship is. That's what's happening right now. You can't see it. But inasmuch as we don't let you have some glimpse of that, then we are letting you down. Because when you come here for worship, thousands upon thousands of angels are already gathered in joyful assembly. Which is the other thing, if you want to become a liturgist like Mark was plugging. The other interesting thing is, see how long it takes in the worship service before people really start smiling. You're better at it than other churches I've known, which will remain nameless, but I will tell you this. There is a church I know, very dear to me, where except in greeting one another on the way in, there were no smiles through the call to worship, opening prayer, hymn, unless they really liked it, call to confession. Well, that's discouraging. Confession, kind of worse. Then the assurance of pardon, that's a little better. And then we'd sing, glory be to the Father and to the Son. But by golly, when we got to passing of the peace, then people realized what they were about, and they'd smile, and they'd greet one another, and it's good to see you, which is fine. Not really what passing of the peace is, but fine. I know that you do. How was your weekend? That's for a different time, but that's fine. I'm not going to fuss with you about that. Joyful assembly. Grave, serious, deadly serious, life or death stuff we're dealing with, but the angels are in joyful assembly around God, and they are worshiping even as we are worshiping, and they're calling us in. Not just the angels, also to the church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. Darned if I didn't leave my book right behind me there on the bench, but I think I can do it. You remember the boy, I've told you the story before, the boy who asked his grandmother to bake him some rolls. And she's happy to make rolls. She makes all kinds of rolls. She makes yeast rolls, Parker House rolls. She makes biscuits, the whole gamut, whatever. But she couldn't quite understand what kind of roll he was talking about. What kind of roll is that you want? He said, I want a pyonder roll. What's a pyonder roll? You know, the pyonder roll. You know, we've talked about it all the time. And suddenly the light came on and she said, I think I know what you're getting at. Tell me the whole story. He said, you know, when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called a pyonder, I'll be there. This is the roll that's called up yonder. Grown-ups sometimes say words in ways that kids have no idea what we're talking about, which is why we can get, instead of passing a piece, the pizza crust be with you. It is why we get Harold the Angel at Christmas times. We need to be a little clearer. This is the roll that's called up yonder. Those whose names are written in heaven, they are there. Plenty of bad songs about what things are really like in heaven and what the experience of people is like in heaven versus here. But this is where they start getting close. If there is someone dear to you who has taught you about God, who has grown you up in the faith, and who is now in the presence of God, you, by golly, ought to think when you're in worship that they are worshiping with you. Not necessarily next to you. They're in the presence of God. But this is the worship we are called to. To the church of the firstborn whose names are written in heaven. And you have come to God. For heaven's sakes, we come in this door and we act like it's no big deal. It's one of the activities we do. You just walked into the presence of a living God when you walked through this door. The judge of all. And you've come to the spirits of the righteous made perfect. Almost never can a funeral go by, particularly if somebody's been sick and then died, that I don't make reference in some way to how God has now healed that person entirely. And I don't mean that's the consolation prize. Actually, now that they are in heaven, they would know that'd be first prize, to have God heal you so entirely that you come into the presence of the Lord. Those righteous in Christ now made perfect. Those who once were injured, those who once were sickly, those who once were weak are now made strong. They're made perfect. And they are worshiping with you right now. And that's an amazing thing. We have a friend before we went to graduate school, we had a friend who sang in choir. So she was up there. Everyone could see her. And every time we said the Apostles' Creed, she'd break out in this great big grin. She's smiling through the Apostles' Creed. And people looking up in the choir, seeing her grinning, would say, why is it that you smile when you recite the Apostles' Creed? She says, I can't help myself. When I recite the Apostles' Creed, I think that the people of God throughout all the ages, for over 1,000 years, have used these words to express their belief. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son. And she says, all I can do is imagine this great cloud of witnesses, which is earlier in Hebrews, early in this chapter, this great cloud of witnesses, this great host of heaven, all joining together to say, I believe, and I believe in Jesus Christ. And she said, it's just like this thunderous chorus of all these saints, known to me and not known, who are all professing the same faith. This is like the greatest mass choir ever, even if we don't make quite enough noise to do it. Okay, so some of you were out late last night watching a certain football game. Some of you watched at home. Better choice. Some of you are there. Fine. But when people join together, tens of thousands, 100,000 people, you know what that can be like. I come from the generation where once there wasn't a wave in stadiums and then there was, and I think that's kind of up and down now. It's on its way out. But the first time that I was in a stadium and you see this amazing just people and all of a sudden they're standing up, woo, and then they sit down again. And it became this cultural icon. And then it became you could carry on a conversation. Yeah, okay. And then you keep talking. But it's this, the first time, it's incredible. And since they're not here because they're on their way home and won't hear this sermon, I'll say, my senior year, when we traveled to Lake Hamilton for the football game, I was not a cheerleader, but I decided, by golly, our stands are going to do the wave. It's a long time ago. They didn't really know what they were doing. But I went horse and ran up and down the stands trying to get our side, the visiting side, to do the wave, and an amazing number of people would do it. Not my parents. But everyone else, just about. I got going, killing me here. And I won't tell what they did for my younger sister and younger brother. But I got them started. It's like that. A huge number of people joining together in the most thrilling, all-consuming, celebratory response to the most amazing thing that's ever happened in the history of the world. God, come down in flesh to take our sins upon Himself so that our sins are taken away. He conquers sin and death and on the cross and His resurrection. And then He says, come on in. We should be on the front porch of heaven when we come into worship. That's what it's about. A living, active God doing things. Thousands upon thousands of angels. You come to the church. You come to God. You come to the saints now made perfect. You come to Jesus. You come. You're joining together with angels and saints and loved ones in joyful assembly in the presence of God. That's why we maintain divine worship, because that's what we're doing. We are part of that heavenly scene, that incredible experience, a vision of the ultimate, completed, perfected company of the people of God gathered around Christ in worship. It's what we're made for. Chief end of human beings, the goal, the meaning, the purpose, why we're created, to glorify God and to enjoy Him. It's supposed to be joyful. So I'll skip over some of the warnings and the scary stuff to get to the very end, because when we are confronted with this incredible invitation that the Lord of the universe would love for us to respond to what He has done for us and for this world in Jesus Christ, we have something to do. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom, that's your inheritance, ought only to go from the Father God to the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, but He is going to share His inheritance with all of us. You are going to receive a kingdom. And by that, I don't mean you get a kingdom and you get a kingdom. No, we are all coming into the same kingdom that cannot be shaken, cannot be destroyed, cannot deteriorate, cannot fade away. With this great gift of eternal life and the inheritance of God, we are receiving, not gonna, we are in the process of receiving it. So, here's how we respond. First, let us be thankful. Let us be thankful. First response to the people of God. One of my favorite seminary professors said, he preached one Sunday night to the church we were going to, and he said, here's the thing, so much emphasis placed on preachers and people learning how to preach, saying, okay, you want to talk about what it originally meant to the first people who heard it, and then you want to talk about what it means to us today. What is God saying to you today? And he said, this is a problem because we hang everything on the application. What are you going to do Monday morning? What are you going to do Wednesday night? What are you going to do Saturday morning before you come to worship again? And that is an appropriate thing for me to have to think through. But here's what stuck in my head all these years. 95% of Scripture, the appropriate response to hearing it, understanding it, having it proclaimed to you is, thank you, Lord. Thanksgiving is almost always the right application, almost always the right response. And it's here in the Bible anyway. Since we are getting this great thing, he says, let us be thankful. One of the most important things you can do is be a person of gratitude and thanksgiving and worship. Let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably. How do you worship acceptably? With reverence and awe. Not an unknown God, not a scary God, not a God who wants to zap you, but still an all-powerful God who created all things, who conquered sin and death and everything else that frightens us and threatens to destroy us. That's a pretty big deal. That's why the hard hats and the life preserver and lashing you to the pews. But it's a God of love, a consuming fire, yes, reverence and awe, but also a God who loved you and me so much that He would die for us, that we might have life in Him. We are here to worship. We are made for worship. Let us give thanks and worship God. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, you have called us into your presence, the presence of a holy, living, all-powerful God. And all around you are angels upon angels, more than we can count. And around you are all those who have gone before us in the faith, all gathered in worship. And that is part of what we do every Sunday morning. Help us to worship you in spirit and truth with all that we have and are, our whole beings, directed to the God of the universe, who would come down and know us and love us and save us. We are thankful, and we do worship in reverence and awe, but continue to inspire us with awe. Continue to